So that means a lot to me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Another question I have is, when is a time or a moment that you felt like really alive or very successful? How do you define that?
Good. Okay. I'm trying to think of a time I felt alive. I love feeling alive. It's great. Even when you have those moments where you're just like, whew, I'm alive. This is a good thing. I'm so like blessed to be here. It's so good. So maybe I could back up a little bit. So I work in on the Midweek Trips program, specifically on like the orientation program, specifically on the Trips program. And when I moved here, you know, I started working on the I think I got this role that's associated with the outdoor programs that makes it be like, oh, you are outdoorsy, obviously, but like that's not necessarily true. I just get this association from my role, but becoming a person that appreciates outdoors was something I did really, I would say later in life, like after college is when I was like, oh, people go outside and they hike and they do cool things and like, oh, that's a good idea, like I'm gonna do that. And I did that, just some friends of mine, I was kind of just like, sometimes I roll through life just being like, whatever. And some friends were like, oh, come on, we're going like rock climbing. And I was like, whatever, cool, like I'll join, I'll go. And so I got to like learn about the outdoors through that activity. And I think one time that I felt alive was I was climbing with one of these people that introduced me to the outdoors. His name is Greg, good friend. It was my birthday. It was my 25th birthday. But nobody knew. I didn't tell anybody. It was just like me and some, I was like, I was with like 10 people, but really the only person's name I remember is Greg. Sorry, other folks. I don't know who they were. Greg was like, well, we're going to go hang out with these people now. And I was just like, okay. And we went climbing, and we were climbing in Colorado, and it was awesome. It was just Greg and I. We were going up, when you go climbing, there's a measurement called a pitch, and there's different, you can go on multi-pitch climbing. So like one pitch might be like the length of a rope, and then the second pitch is the next length of a rope. So we were doing this multi-pitch climbing, so we were pretty far off the ground, and we were on, yeah, it was kind of scary, but Greg's really, at the time, I was, like, really blissfully ignorant, like, I was like, oh, Greg knows what he's doing, like, this is fine, like, I'm safe, I feel good, but later on, I was like, wow, as I learned more about rock climbing, that was really bad. So we got up to these pitches, and we were having tons of fun, and, like, working hard, but enjoying, like, we were in this canyon, so there was a beautiful river running through, and you could see all some sorts of good stuff. El Dorado Canyon. Anna's from Colorado.
It's true.
and we got to the last pitch, and it was going to be too hard for me. Like, I knew there's different grading systems, and I was like, Greg, I can't do this. And he's like, well, I really want to try it. Do you mind if I try? And then I'll, like, get myself back down, and you can come, and then we'll lower and we'll get back to the ground. And I was like, okay, Greg, sounds good. So he's trying to, he's climbing and he's doing a great job, but he gets this really hard part. And he like works on this hard part for like a long time, like maybe 30 minutes. And I'm just like sitting there belaying him, being like, oh, this is so pretty. Like to the east was like a beautiful sunset. I'm just, or like the clouds were turning like pink, like alpenglow. And I'm like, oh, it's so pretty. And then suddenly I looked to the left and it was just like dark mountain or like bad clouds coming our way. And Greg's up there being like, oh, like trying so hard. And I'm like, huh, like should I tell Greg that there is impending doom coming? Or like, and so this is like me feeling alive was like suddenly like just trying to be like, Greg, I think you should look to the left, and I'm like starting to feel nervous, and he's like, whoa, oh boy. So he has to like get himself down, which he does, and we meet up, and by the time he gets down to where I'm at, it's like, it's thundering, and we are like probably 500 feet off the ground. And I felt pretty alive in that moment, just like being like, wow, we are screwed. It's going to start raining. So Greg is really proficient at what he does as a rock climber, and I was really nervous, so he was like tying all my knots and doing all the proper things, but we rappelled. As we got to the ground, it started lightning, and one of our friends picked us up in a car. Name, can't remember, but I felt pretty alive then in that moment. It was really scary, and I hope to never do anything like that again. But I don't know if I would say that was a feeling of success either. That was actually a feeling of stupidity. but I felt pretty alive in that moment.
Okay. So I'm curious, is in hindsight, looking at that moment, and like, do you think the reason that you felt alive was more just like adrenaline, like in this crazy situation, or do you think it sheds light on some larger things that are important to you?
Yeah, I think it does. I mean, I think the adrenaline is probably like a huge piece of that story. Also feeling like we're playing around with this precious body and this precious gift of life, like that makes it feel alive. So I think, but the elements that make me think about what is important to me, or like what about that scenario was important, is like trust and honesty. Like, so trusting somebody else to be in a situation like that is important to me. Like, and I would say just the trust in general, and having some faith that things are gonna work out is like something that feels important to me. I don't know that I'm always good at. I like looking at Kurt because we go climbing together a lot and we fight a lot when we do it. But or just like having faith that things will work out. I want to have that be something that I exude all the time. But you know, I definitely get worried or get anxious about things as far as like, is this the right decision or is this working out? I think that setting in the outdoors also provides an opportunity to feel connected to nature and like put down the phone and be away from the computer. And that's something that, like, again, like my ideal world, my ideal self is like, oh, that's so easy to do. And like, what is a phone? Like, I don't know. I wish that was the sort of person that I was all the time, but putting myself in scenarios where I'm outside and there's no service or there's no computers or there's no desks even or walls, like that is something that is when I feel my best self, is when I'm outside and like disconnected from all that stuff, which is not always easy to do, but I feel like it does matter to me to make space for that in my life. So one-sided. I want to be like, what about you, Anna?
I don't know. I'm going against the rules.
Okay, so that makes me wonder, like those larger things, like trust, and maybe it sounds like kind of being more present, mm-hmm. like how you feel mm-hmm. in outdoors. You said you got into being physically in outdoors like kind of later on, mm-hmm. but when do you think you started having a better idea of what is important to you in those, like,
it's a good question. I think it's one reason why I like working at a college, but I think between like the age of 18 to I would say 26, 27 was a real time of like instability and figuring out what is important to me, and that, like, I'm excited that continues beyond college. I'm excited for like college students in the room. That like, I think there's this perception that everyone is like, yes, college is an interesting time and like you'll learn and grow and change, but the time after college is also like, I think, part of that. So it's exciting. So enjoy, like, good luck. So I mean, I think I really went to college. I grew up in like a predominantly white neighborhood, like high middle class, whereas a lot of my friends or neighbors, but I would feel like lower middle class. And I think I just sort of took a lot for face value. I didn't do a lot of questioning, like in high school, like, oh, why aren't there people of color in my neighborhood? Or why do so many people, like, it was, I think where I lived was pretty conservative, both politically and socially. So then I went to school at the University of New Hampshire, and like, it lived up to its liberal, I think, leanings as far as like a seacoast, eastern seacoast place. So that was where I really started to think more about what I value and what's important to me. And as you start managing your own time and realizing that there's not a lot of it, like making choices about what I wanted to do based on my values. So I think like that age was really when I started to think about what mattered to me and what was important to me and what I valued. But, and that continues, but I think for me, as I've become more stable, both economically in a relationship, in my job, like some of those questioning moments have like petered, and you have to work for it, I think, more as an adult than you do as a college age student to like put yourself, like this is one for me, like put yourself in a situation where you have to rethink about that. So I don't even know what your original question was.
Yeah, I answered it. I'd give it an A.
Thanks, Anna.
You're welcome, Amanda. Okay. So let me know if you think this question is dumb, considering what you just said.
Okay.
But I'm curious, I feel like a lot of people, like childhood is a very formative mm-hmm. time. Mm-hmm. And I also think it makes sense, I experience also that when you get some space away from where you're from, like you start questioning more.
Right.
But when you look back, are there any like defining moments from your mm-hmm. childhood years that shaped what's important to you?
Oh, sure. That is a good, deep question. Who invited her? I did. Of course, yeah, definitely, of course. There was totally, I grew up in a single family home. My mom's a single mom. Every day, that's still, sorry. I'm like, I'm a crier. That's just what I do. So, forgive me. So that's something that I carry with me. So I'm like, can you tell us a joke real quick?
I can. Do you like me to?
Yeah.
Knock knock. Isabel. Isabel broke and I had to knock. Thank you.
Thanks. So anyways, just like anybody else, I think, you know, you have things that you're trying. Look at Liz Cleveland. Thanks, Liz. So yeah, and I had two older sisters. I talked to them, like, we fought a lot when I was a kid. You know, I hated them and they hated me. but, you know, now they're like my best friends, and I didn't mention them earlier. I won't send them the YouTube clip. I think one thing that I'm like that I'll talk about so I just don't cry a lot, but is that I was like, I was pretty athletic as a kid, so like, and hyper. I was very hyper as a small child, and my mom would be like, I'd be like, mom, and she would like walk by, and I'd like jump on her back, and she'd be like, ah, like you're killing me slowly, and she'd be like, you have to get out of here, like you're not allowed in the house right now, and go run like 10 laps around the house is something that she would say to me frequently. And I'd be like, okay, like, good idea, you're smart. And I would just like go run around my house 10 times. And then I'd be ready to come back in and she'd let me back in. And then, So, and I would, because my sisters hated me and I hated them, I was often like playing, I would want to play with them. Let me be clear. Like, I'd be like, can you guys please play with me? And they'd be like, no. So I would be like off climbing trees by myself and just like sitting in the tree. And I think there's like parts of me that still like benefit from, even though at the time I was like, they're mean. I'm like, that's cool that I spend some time alone, like climbing trees, running around my house by myself. And that sort of translated to me participating in sports as like a kid throughout middle school and high school. And I think for me, that helped me be able to gain confidence in who I am and feel socially connected to other people. And I was a runner, so like that was like a little like bit like in the caste system of socialness at, in my high school. It was like not that cool. So I was able to find like other people who just accepted me for who I was, and like it was like, wow, you're not that cool, but we like you. And like, you're like, hey, thanks, I feel the same way about you. So like just this motley crew of misfits, and I was like pretty good at it. I could run like pretty fast, and I gained a lot of like social capital, I think, from that. And so like I said, it helped me gain a lot of confidence, and I had a really good relationship with my coaches, and they like taught me a lot about like physical well-being. And I think for me that carries over to who I am today, because it's like if I'm not doing something active, I'm definitely more apt to feel like blah, like not good about myself or what I'm doing in life. And it really helps me to be able to that have that consistency of like a routine and stuff like that. And so, but I learned that as a kid, that was something that I needed. And so I'm able to keep doing that now. That won't make me cry.
Thanks for sharing.
You're welcome.
So those things that make you feel like not blah.
Yeah.
How do you think your role here at Middlebury College like fits in with what's important to you, mm-hmm. and hopefully makes you feel not blah?
Yeah. Does that make sense? Yeah, well, I think in my role at Middlebury, I get to interact with students, I would say, a good portion of the time. It's not like all day, every day with students. I'm like, I'm not like a dean in that realm of like meeting with people while they're in crisis, but I get to know people, and my interaction with students definitely helps me feel like, yay, like this is exciting and fun. And I think some of what, like what I'm talking about, like needing routines and needing physical activity to feel good, I try to like bring that to my work. Like, I think it's really a bummer that so many people on this campus specifically like struggle with mental health, and it's just like sad. I think it's really sad, but I try to see my role as like someone who can bring some light and to like be like, take three classes. Like, I'm like, don't stress yourself out over all this stuff. Like, it doesn't, I mean, like, obviously it's important, but it's not like I'm like, ugh. Like, if it doesn't feel good, don't do it. And I try to model that for students, and I try to model, like, let's have some fun. I'm, like, crying. but, like, you know, like, let's lighten up, and, like, I think Middlebury doesn't always have like a sense of humor. I'm just like, ugh, like we are like very white, Protestant, like buttoned up, like, now what should we do? I'm just like over it a little bit. I'm like, whatever about that. Like, like everybody's like working hard enough, like let's just breathe and take a moment and go outside and have some fun, and like that's equally as important as a lot of the other stuff that we spend our time doing. I don't know why it makes me cry.
It's important.
Yeah.
Okay, I've got a little thought experiment.
Oh, good.
If you were given $1,000 and you have to spend it in a week, what would you do with it?
$1,000. Sorry, this is funny. I'm like, it's already gone. It's already gone.
We can up it.
No.
10,000.
Okay, that's good. 10,000. With 1,000, so.
As a student, I was like,
that was like,
I can't even imagine.
That was that scene from Austin Powers where it was like $1,000,000. They just laughed. I'm sorry, I just lost Austin Powers too. First I'll tell you what I do with $1,000 and then we'll move on. So Kerr and I just bought a house and it's really fun. And we really want a wood stove. The heat is just so nice. And you get to split the wood, and you get to, right? This is obviously from the words of someone who doesn't have a wood stove, because it's really hard work. You split the wood, and you carry it in, you make the fire, and you're sort of, it connects back to that, this feeling of being present and being in the moment. And sort of, it's a different way of, to me, being connected with where you live. Like, you know, just go there and it's warm. Like, if you have a wood stove, you have to make the fire, you have to make sure it keeps going. You have to clean it so that you don't, like, die from carbon monoxide or crystal, you know, so there's, like, a different connection with the place that you live. So, I would buy, with $1,000, I would buy a wood stove. And that probably wouldn't get you exactly, well, if you installed it, we'd be over, but let's just move this. we're learning all these things about money, and I don't recommend buying a house. I mean, like, for the college students in the room, like, it's not like something to be like, I have to do this venture, like, this is a goal. It will happen if it's meant to be, but I don't think it's the end all be all. But we're really excited about it, so we buy wood stove. And then, with $10,000, probably go on a long vacation. I've never been to Thailand. I'd really like to be to Thailand. Kurt has a 13-year-old daughter, and she lives with us. She asked me last night, where would you go if you could go anywhere? I said Thailand, so I'll say that again here. But there's so, I mean, it you could be name endless with how far I'd want to go. I might want to buy a motorcycle if I had $10,000, or at least a moped thing, scooter thing to ride to work on. That'd be really fun. A dog. Dogs are expensive.
Word.
So I'd buy a dog, and I would, yeah, and then just take my family on a big trip or something. I think that's what I'd do. Nice. I think that might get us to $10,000.
Yeah, I mean, I clearly don't know. But I believe okay, similarly, if you were given like 10 extra hours in this week, ooh, and you don't, it's like waking hours. It's
okay.
Not like you're gonna be more
I
tired.
I don't even have, I'm not gonna be more tired.
Okay. You know you're not gonna be more tired, okay, for using them.
That
would you
be
do with
such
them?
A gift. Can you imagine that? That would be so cool. Mm-hmm. I would, 10 hours. I would, at the end, there would be a really big potluck meal that Abby Bohm cooks, mostly. Abby Bohm is an old roommate and a fantastic chef. So that would be at the end of the day, with lots of folks around. I'd wake up and I'd have a long glass of coffee, like on our deck, watching some birds. Really into the birds right now. And we have some binoculars on Sunday. It's also a nice day in these 10 extra hours, right? And we'd watch the birds for a little while. Kurt would be there, and we have like the bird. We're like birders right now. We got the bird books out, and we would do this, and there'd be so many birds. And then maybe a little yoga. This is cool because I'm like, this is what I already do. So I haven't really gotten beyond that. But I think I would head over to the Adirondacks, 10 extra hours after that beautiful morning, and do some climbing, maybe some hiking, and then come back and have dinner with Abby Bloom cooking.
I get hours too.
You get hours too, extra for you. Extra for everyone. You get a whale. Extra hours for everybody. I think I would keep it pretty simple. I don't think that I would do anything extraordinary. Maybe I should say, like, help people. I probably should have said that.
No.
I probably wouldn't have done that.
But the thing is, I feel like when you feel good, then it makes other people feel good.
That's what I like to think. Well, and I think, like, our world is just so busy, busy, busy that, and everyone's working so hard that it's hard to imagine putting in 10 hours of just, like, doing it, like, putting more into the, whether it's my job or the community. I think everybody's always working so hard, so for me, I would take that time for myself, and I would enjoy it. Sorry.
That sounds like a great 10 hours.
You can come.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm really scared of climbing.
You can just bring a hammock. That's like the best part of climbing is actually the sitting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because you're just like in the woods.
Yeah.
So it's not always about the climbing. It's also about the sitting.
I've come. Those are all the questions that I had, but do you have anything else about what's important to you and why it is that you would like to share?
Not specifically. I think it's like a great question. I'm really glad to have had the opportunity to think about it, even if I didn't always articulate it right. But I think it's important for everybody to think about. And there's like, it's like everything. In my first, I was like, everything matters. Everything matters. So like, there's only some things that I touched upon today, and they're all shaped by, you know, who I am, my identities, where I'm in my life right now. And so I think that for everybody, and I think it's true for me, that it's always evolving, that what matters changes from the role I'm in to where I am to who I'm with, and everything. Everything matters. So thanks to Megan and the Center for Social Entrepreneurship for having the opportunity and putting the question out in the world. I think it's good.
Thanks, Amanda.
Yeah, thanks for sharing.
Thanks for being here. Anna and I were cat matching cats.
Yeah, I noticed.
That was a question.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Am I supposed to take a question?
Yeah, if anybody, we can open it up to questions for Amanda.
Oh, good.
What's your name? I'm Lucy, and I work with Megan at the Innovation Center.
Nice to meet you.
Group. I am wondering, I was also like an athlete throughout my whole life, and feel very similarly that I need to find ways to stay active and have a routine in order not to feel bleh.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, in that first, I swam throughout college, so I'm in that first year of like trying to figure out like how to weave it into my day.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering, A, like what kind of things that you do to make you not feel off, and if you are still like trying to find ways to be competitive, or if you just do it for yourself.
Sure.
What do you like to do?
Yeah, I will say first and foremost that as a human being who's like biology, like I feel like I am programmed, I'm naturally lazy. Like I mostly like I have a lot of energy and stuff, but like I think our bodies are programmed like for when we had to hunt and find our own food to like like when you can have the time to rest. So I think it's something like I have to work towards like all the time. It's not just like, it's like I have to psych myself up just like anybody else. But I would say because I was competitive I think a big motivator for me is like signing up for races or stuff like that. So I try to do that. I don't know if I would say often, but when I'm feeling like in a rut of like, I'm not feeling motivated, I definitely am like, okay, I got to find some sort of race to sign up for, whether it's a team reach the beach sort of situation, or like a 5K or a triathlon. Like I've never, I started doing some triathlons in the past like 2 years, and they're terrible. They're really hard, but it's fun to push myself in a different way.
Yeah.
And I think for me, one thing that I like a lot about working at Middlebury is I have a supervisor who's like very much trusts how I use my own time. And so like I'm not necessarily an early riser, but I can get up and work out before I even go to work. So I've learned that like if I wait, if I'm like, oh, I'll work out during lunch or like in the afternoon, it like never happens. It just like doesn't happen. So I still rely on running a lot. I love going to Cats. If you haven't gone to Cats,
I go.
I go to the 8:30. See, you're hardcore. I go to the 8:30 because my boss is so nice and he lets me do that. But also because I can't wake up at 6:15. But it's a really fun community to be of, like, you go and these people have a workout for you just there, and you're like, great, I'll do it. And you're like, wow, this is so hard. And you just feel like a powerhouse, like the rest of you know about it. So I don't know. I think you just have to experiment and be willing to try new things, and to be honest with yourself about what is going to be, like, what does work for you. So I lie to myself when I'm like, I'm going to work out in the afternoon, but I know I'm not. It's just like, I should just say I don't want to work out today. Mm-hmm. That's what I should just say. But I don't. Yeah. Good luck. We can work out sometime.
Yeah.
And fun.
How do you feel about the animal cats? And how has that those feelings evolved over time?
No, that is what it is. Those feelings have evolved over time. I used to hate cats with a fiery passion. I know, it's like, why am I even sitting here with you? But I love them now. I love kitty meow meows. I'm allergic to cats. So when I was a kid, I had like pretty terrible experiences with cats, like going to friends' houses and being like slightly asthmatic because I'm like rolling around in their cat hair and like being like, God, these cats are worthless. They do nothing for me. And then Kurt had brought this great gift into my life of having a cat. And I was like, when we started dating, I was like, oh my God, this guy has a cat. Is he normal? Is he okay? Is he gonna? But he's great. And his cat is really great. His name's Hunter. So I've had this cat vest for a really long time, and I used to wear it because I was like, this is a hilarious joke because I'm wearing this cat vest and everybody thinks I love cats, but actually I hate cats. And I'd be like, nobody knows how much I hate cats. And now I wear it because I love cats. So Hunter was on our bed. He's on our bed all the time. And I was like, I guess I have to go get allergy medicine. I have like an allergy doctor in Burlington, all for the sake of the cat. So that he can be on the bed and so I can hold him like a little baby. So now I love cats, so you don't have to be worried anymore. Anna is a cat whisperer. Because so Hunter doesn't really like people until he gets to know them. Oh, my phone's kind of a cat whisperer too. And when Anna came over, Hunter let her touch him. And Maddie has come to our house too, and Hunter likes Maddie. So good job, people. Thanks. Yeah. Cool. Any other burning desires, questions? Great. Oh, Liz.
What's it like having a 13-year-old daughter around that?
It's cool. Kurt knows. I mean, it's really interesting. It's so interesting. What a time of life, right, to be 13. And, like, I think one thing I really like is those moments where, you know, she's like, oh, you guys, I know it's 8. I have to turn off my phone. Like, don't tell me what to do. I know. I'm old. I'm big. I'm responsible. And we're like, okay. And then she'll be like, And then she'll be like, I didn't know how to turn the, like, turn the shower on. And you're like, oh, you're still a kid. You are, like, in this interesting phase of being really, like, learning how to be your own person and taking care of yourself. But sometimes you just need help with things like, will you toast my English muffin in the morning? This is a conversation that we have a lot about toasting the English muffin. But she still wants that and wants to be taken care of in those ways. So, and sometimes she's like, it's really fun because you see that in, and maybe this is just Abby as a person, but I could imagine it as like 13-year-olds, like you want, you're like really concerned about what other people think of you. I remember I felt that way. I think it's like pretty natural. You think everybody's looking at you, but like everybody thinks that, so nobody's actually paying attention to anybody. But like you have that desire to feel okay and like know that other people accept you and like you. And so it's like an honor to watch that process and be like, get to be a person that's like, I like you, and get to see her when she's really silly, and you're like, you are such a weirdo. I like, and it's great, and know that she doesn't let other people always see her be super strange. So that's like a gift. You're a mom. Is it weird? What's it like? What did you think when they were 13?
You're right. What an honor. I think you're right.
Right.
If they let you.
Yeah.